Very good to this progress report today, together with Sebastian Rio from Princeton University, which stresses the very close connection of the work done at our two institutions. Co-authors of the presentations, you can see, are also Rob Goldstone, Alice Glaser, who proposed the application of the zero-knowledge approach to work in their education. You have heard an overview of the approach. You'll hear more about the specific implementation application of the approach by Sebastian in a few minutes. So right now, I would just like to focus on the requirements, the detector requirements that we at Yale work with in order to develop a system, an implementation, let's say, of a zero-knowledge approach using non-electronic devices. The idea there being that with non-electronic devices, fewer chances exist of fooling the system. And these devices should have a series of properties, a series of features that are listed here. The idea is to use them both in transmission and emission measurements, so verifying the geometry and composition, and in more detail, the isotopic composition. That's the correct one of the devices being examined. The devices being non-electronic will be integrating devices that accumulate signal, accumulate counts. I'll show you how. And one important feature that they have is having essentially no memory effect. So when they're exposed incrementally, when incremental neutron fluids reach them.
Not loud enough?
Oh yeah. When incremental fluids is, did you hear what I said before?
Yeah.
When incremental fluids is reached, and we don't want to be able to recognize, to distinguish between the first exposure, second, third, and so on. So that, again, there may be a preload, as it's called, of signal in the detectors, which are then exposed a second time, and the combination of the signals gives, or rather doesn't, the information that we're after. The detectors, as you see there, should store thousands of counts, should be insensitive to gamma rays, and on the other hand, sensitive to neutrons above selected thresholds. Whether used for emission studies, we want a relatively low threshold, perhaps around half an MeV, so that maybe 200 keV neutrons may be used for really activation, for triggering fission. And then we'd have the ability of measuring a wide portion of the fission spectrum that is emitted. So the detectors that we developed at Yale, which were invented at Yale by Professor Affel in the late 1970s, do satisfy, we think, these requirements. Without going into details, we reviewed this in at the kickoff meeting. These are detectors that are suspensions of superheated or metastable fluids, so not scintillators, not gas field detectors. Here we have a phase transition that is triggered by neutral recoils. And because it's triggered by neutral recoils, high LET, high energy recoils, these detectors are not sensitive to photons. That is, to photon release electrons. We can make them with different thresholds. The thresholds depend on the material, the perfluorocarbons that we disperse in the emulsion. So different perfluorocarbons at different boiling points. Different boiling points correspond to different thresholds. So that's what we can do. They do not achieve the intrinsic efficiencies that you can get from scintillators. They're far from those levels, even far from what you get from well-moderated helium-3 counters. But we can already achieve around 3% efficiency. For fast neutrons, we think we can hit 5%. But for these applications, the sensitivity is not really a key requirement. We have plenty of neutrons to work with, so that's really not a big issue. We can make them, however, with different sensitivities. What you see here are a series of detectors that we have made. The three ones on the left-hand side were made with droplets of the same size, which means that bubbles that we get are also of the same size, but different amounts of droplets. And therefore, you get different amounts of bubbles for the same exposure. These were all exposed to the same neutron fluids. The fourth one has smaller drops, lower sensitivity. The fifth one is actually a commercial device. You get even fewer bubbles from those. So one thing that made the Princeton folks happy is that you get lots of counts from our detectors. Something else you get from our detectors compared to the commercial devices is that bubbles do not grow appreciably over time after they have formed. Here you see pictures of what we call commercial detectors. and our detectors taken right after an exposure and one day later. And clearly in the commercial devices you have a significant growth of the bubbles, which again does not happen with ours. That's because the matrix in the commercial devices is a rigid polymer, so it slowly expands up until the full size of the bubbles is reached. Ours yield much more rapidly, so the bubbles immediately reach their full size. The images that you've seen are important because bubbles are counted optically. That's at least what we do now, although we're looking for other ways of counting the bubbles. And here's a picture of a detector with the bubbles inside. The response is very linear. I'm happy to say that these detectors have sort of also been used and investigated at the University of Illinois. Claire's group is looking into ways of detecting bubbles and counting them, so we hope we'll soon have a method that is sort of established as a way to count the bubbles. So I've said this, I'm going to pass the floor to Sebastian, who will tell you again about the first results, because the method has been applied this year.
Well, thank you, Francesco. Those bubble detectors, are in fact magic, I believe. And those are not my words, but the words of Dick Garwin when he read Team of the Project. So what this is about, it's, you know, as Eric told us already, and I won't spend too much time on this, what is our gap and challenge here? The gap is basically 13,000 nuclear weapons. We account today under strategic limitation treaties for about 3,000 nuclear weapons by counting basically their daily vehicles. And what we want to do and try to achieve is flip the way we do actually arms control, flip the way we want to do nuclear arms control. And I think this, if we, part of this consortium, can achieve interesting results in this way, we will have done a very good job as a citizen, scientist. Why is this hard? Why is this a challenge? Well, warhead inspections are hard. And if you look at this from the inspector perspective, it's fairly easy to understand why. First, very little of any information about the inspected item can be revealed. So you don't know what you're going to inspect. Adversary competitors are almost de facto infinite resources. They might try to deceive you, as the stakes become higher and higher, number of weapons eventually shrink. It might really put a lot of resources in trying to deceive your inspection system. And finally, something that is quite amazing is the fact that the host usually has last ownership of the inspection system, not only before the inspection, but also after the inspection. That means that you can never, as an inspector, rewind the tape of whatever happens. You can never replay what happened during the inspection. It's very, very hard. So the two approaches, we mentioned them already, have been developed, mostly information barriers in the past, for more than 20 years. Very interesting work. One of the issues with it is trust. And it's probably the most complex problem I call this hard. Those hardware and software devices are extremely hard to authenticate and certify. The reason you want to make sure they work on the day of the inspection, you want the inspection to make sure that the device is working as it's supposed to be. And that there's no Volkswagen switch that you can put on and obtain different results on Tuesday and Thursday. The concept here is that you measure sensitive information and you sanitize it. And you produce single bit observation, red light, green light. On the other end, what we're trying to develop at Princeton and what our colleagues at MIT are now working on is a concept that is called zero knowledge proof. And this comes, as we said, from the crypto community. First crypto advance that was invented in a kind of like for digital application, but not in the physical world, and so we're trying to revert back in time what happened in cryptography. The idea here is, it's not a very secure system, in the sense that people think zero knowledge is super secure. It doesn't need to be super secure because we don't measure sensitive information in the first place. So zero knowledge doesn't mean super highly secure because there actually no sense of security. It is much easier to authenticate and certify, as Francesco told us. Because here we don't use electronics, we build our analysis on the laws of thermodynamics. they unfortunately, and not unfortunately, probably more fortunately, produce very complex observations, which allow inspectors to gain much more confidence in the results, in the way that they will be able to catch divergent scenarios and actually learn, you know, sometimes if the host eventually was trying to cheat, they will know what it was trying to do. So the basis for our protocol, in 5 minutes, radiographic quality. Very simple. It is actually so simple that it's a little bit, it's difficult for me to present this after, you know, all this extreme high level of science. What I just do is I take radiograph of items and I sum their radiograph on their complement radius. And so if I have an item A and an item B, and I use the radiograph of A and I sum it with its complement A, I usually obtain a flat image, statistically flat. And the beauty about high particle physics here is we're in the realm of Poisson statistics. So not only the signals carry no noise, but the not only the signal carry no information, but the noise itself carry no information as well. If I were to tamper with one of the items, well, I would basically just see features appearing on my spectrum. This is how the system was envisioned in the past. We illuminate objects presented for inspection on detector arrays that are preloaded with the internal radiograph of our system. So let me show you now how it looks like so far in real life. I'm not going to cover completeness on the zero knowledge, we heard about it. Just one thing, we have really to prove this when we show, experimentally, the experimental demonstration is here basically to prove those 3 points. So our first experiment was this. We do not have, classified objects in our lab, of course. We didn't want to propose at the beginning, objects that people would tell us, well, we shouldn't use this kind of geometry because it's a little bit sensitive. So I just picked cubes, right? Because what I was interested here is geometry and opacity to 14 MeV neutrons. So I created reference item and invalid items by simply placing different cubes of metals in a certain pattern. I took one of this pattern and called it my reference item that you can see here on the right, and I basically took a lot of radiographs of that item. And to be able to produce a preload of good quality for the rest of my measurements. And because we're also trying to debunk kind of like the way we do inspections, we use black box, we try to prevent an inspector to see the detectors when they set up, when we set up the system. So we also, as we do experimental work, we also try to debunking the way inspector will actually run this and be confident in the results. So here are some of the results. In some sense, the zero knowledge results is the most boring one because you don't learn anything, right? So here, what I did is we had preloaded the reference item in the set of bubble detectors that you saw, and then we re-irradiated valid item. So we summed their radiograph from the complement radiograph, and what we obtained, and we can run tons of statistical tests, is basically Poisson distribution as we were expected. When I started to run invalid item, so first the easy cases like this one, where you swap completely, with your item, you just just flip it. Directly, you see that something is wrong, right? We have much more signal on the right, much less on the left, so something happened. What this tells us also is that there is an incentive for the host not to cheat in this protocol, because zero knowledge is only guaranteed when you're truthful. As soon as you cheat, you will leak information. Information will go, knowledge will be revealed, and you may actually give up some of your nuclear weapon secrets. Here it's a smaller change, tiny little change on the right in 14 MeV neutron opacity that we were able to cut. But of course, the game now is to try to get even better and better at this resolution. And to do so, our statistics in there is the number of bubbles we have in our detectors. And this is, you know, the work we do with Yale, and, you know, what Francesco is trying to produce for us, a much larger number of bell counts for the day. So, to wrap this up, our next step, experimental reproducibility of results. So this is what basically we're doing right now. We want to increase our statistics, so maximize the bubble loading and our counting efficiency. We also want to move beyond geometry and opacity and be able to catch variation in isotopic composition of the materials that are presented for inspection. Finally, we want also to develop data commitment schemes. Here the idea is that if something goes wrong from the host perspective, like you misalign something or you know, he makes a mistake by himself, we want to give him a chance to maybe look at the data first in a way that the inspectors will have confidence that the data has not been tampered with. So everyone is happy at the end. And beyond the lab, here at Princeton and at PPPL, we'll be very excited to do some experiments with our activity process. Thank you very much.
So at that point, you're pretty sure that the warhead is real. Because in order for a country to have a nuclear deterrence, they need to have real weapons on real ICBMs. Okay. So now that you have